come across various types of people in our day-to-day life. Most of them are ordinary people who do what they're supposed to do. We also see some among the ordinary who stand projected. They perform excess than what was targeted from them. Then we see few exceptional people who do the most unpredicted in a manner never expected or even thought of. Most of their actions are unacceptable at first sight, but when they walk through the corridor of life, we just follow them, feeling amazed and unassumed.
Life of Mr. Bunker Roy and Aruna Roy says exemplary stories, happening of the most impossible in the least segments in society.
When you start something, you can never say 30 years down the line, it will look like this. Not possible. It grows, it evolves, it makes a mistake, it comes back, it starts again. If you haven't failed ever, then there's something wrong with you. You're not Superman. Either you're not admitting that you failed, and if you failed, then you say why you failed, and it's honest if you say why you failed, and then people can learn from that. Very difficult for people who have been through formal education today to actually, first of all, do anything which might fail, because they don't want to fail. And if they have failed, they won't talk about it, which is even worse. So we have major problem with the formal educational system with me. I have no faith in the formal education system as it is structured today to produce results, especially if it is supposed to help the very poor in this world today. Solutions don't come from Harvard and don't come from Cambridge and they don't come from Stanford. No way. The solutions come from below. And unless you understand what solutions are there below, you know.
Sanjit Bunker Roy was born in West Bengal in 1945, studied in the prestigious Doon School from 1956 to 1962, attended St. Stephen's College, Delhi from 1962 to 1967, and earned his master's degree in English. Surprised his parents, deciding to devote himself to the welfare of people in the rural villages in India and world.
I went to a very, very expensive school and college in India. And in 1965, I went to a village for the first time and it changed my life. And I came back home and I told my mother that, you know, I'd like to live and work in a village. Something hit me in the village and I'd like to go back and contribute. There's something that I want to give back to society. She wouldn't speak to me for many years. The only time she actually accepted me was when the Prince and Princess of Wales came to Thelonia for the first time.
He is the man who founded the Barefoot College in 1972 in Rajasthan. There is no entry for those who come with degree certificate.
The Barefoot College is 500 kilometers southwest of Delhi, and it's a place which is the only college built by the poor, run by the poor, and managed by the poor. And the first thing the poor told me was, please, give knowledge, skill, wisdom more importance than paper qualifications. It's a place where we have a very different definition of professional. A professional is someone who has a combination of competence, confidence and belief. So we built the Barefoot College with barefoot architects who still can't read and write today. But they built my college at $1.50 a square foot, and it is the only college in India where we have only used barefoot architects. It is the only college in India which is fully solar energized. For the next 25 years, I have no problem with water and power, even though it is in the middle of Rajasthan where it sometimes does not rain for 5 years. And it was built by someone who's done only 8 years of primary schooling. Everyone sits on the floor, eats on the floor, works on the floor. No one comes for the money as much as for the challenge. No one is allowed to get more than $100 a month, even if you stay there for 30 years, because the money is not as important. 60% of the children in India can't go to school in the morning because they look after goats and cattle and sheep. So we try and see that we start a school for night. The night schools of Thelonia are for children who can't go to school in the morning, but they go to school at night. But the most important thing is that we teach the children democracy, citizenship, responsibility. So every 3 years, 7,000 children between ages 6 and 14 elect a Prime Minister.
Bunker Roy was selected among the 100 most influential personalities in the world by Time magazine in 2010. His father was a mechanical engineer and his mother retired as India's trade commissioner to Russia. Bunker was a sportsman of note at school. Barefoot College is the only college that opens only to people without any formal education.
Education started when I lived and worked in a village. And I found that every day of the 40 years that I've been there, I've been surprised by what I learn, the simple solutions that I find that are inexpensive, community-based, and something which always surprised me, how these people who've never been to school and college can come up with something so inexpensive and real. So I'm always surprised when I'm living and working in a village. I am surprised how detached people are in OECD from the realities of life. The policies that I've read so far have not really been in touch with what's happening on the ground. And I think it needs to be revisited much more, with much more sympathy, compassion, patience, tolerance than it is today.
Roy's idea is that India and Africa are full of people with skills, traditional knowledge and practical resourcefulness who are not recognized as engineers, architects or water experts, but who can bring more to communities than governments or big businesses.
The Prime Minister today is 12 years old. She looks after 20 goats in the morning, but she is Prime Minister in the evening. The beauty is that we have actually spread this whole demystification, decentralized, solar electrified village approach outside India. We took the barefoot approach to Africa. 21 countries in Africa have got the barefoot approach. We've trained about 140 mothers. But what we are doing is we are only training grandmothers. We are not training men. Men are ambitious, men are restless, and men want a certificate. The women, rooted to the soil, patient, tolerant, compassionate, and willing to learn, and they will not leave. The only reason why we don't give certificates after training is that they leave. The moment you hand a certificate in the hand of any man in Africa, within 24 hours he'll leave his village and go to a city looking for a job. A woman will never do that. We don't allow the World Bank or the UN to come into the Barefoot College because they've got nothing to tell us that we don't know already. Look at the tremendous knowledge and skills that very poor people have that are unutilized, unrecognized today. Where is it written that just because you can't read and write, you cannot become a teacher, a verbal, oral teacher, or a doctor, or a designer, or a computer expert? School is what you learn how to read and write. Education is what you get from your family, your environment, and your community.
The college trains the poor to combine local knowledge with new green technologies. Barefoot College has trained more than 3 million people for jobs in the modern world. People have learned to become barefoot water and solar engineers, architects and teachers. It has helped hundreds of communities across India and now in 7 other countries install water supplies and solar voltaic lighting systems, develop bicycles that can cross rivers and design buildings that can collect every drop of water.
Well, I was drilling and blasting wells, and it so happened that one of the drillers who taught me how to drill and blast came from a village called Thelonia, and he said, well, would you like to come to my village? I said, no, not really interested. But he sort of kept persuading me, and then finally I went. Being exposed to that sort of knowledge and skill, I would like to start a college built by the poor for the poor only. And a barefoot college is supposed to be a college only for the poor.
Bunker Roy utilizes traditional expertise rather than bookish knowledge for the upliftment of neglected communities. Roy was influenced by Mahatma Gandhi and Mao Zedong. He modeled his organization after Mao's barefoot doctors.
I will stop with a quotation from Gandhi. He said, first they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, and then you win.
In 1970, Roy married his classmate Aruna Roy, then an officer in the Indian Administrative Service. Aruna served as a civil servant in the Indian Administrative Service between 1968 and 1974. She then resigned to devote her time to social and political campaigns. She joined the Social Work and Research Center in Tilonia, Rajasthan.
I think what really is, for me, even today, after so many years of the Right to Information movement and after 5 years of the Act, I still feel awed that this thing has happened. So today we are talking about how India and Brazil, I don't know which other country was mentioned, is full of self-flagellation, but what they cannot do. I would like to say, I'd begin on a very optimistic note, that I think this country has tremendous potential, that if the people of this country, with all the corruption and all the mafia and all the systems that have gone wrong in this country.
Aruna has achieved fame as a political and social activist. She became a prominent leader of the Right to Information movement and in 2000 received the Ramon Magsaysay Award for Community Leadership.
I think we should not fix priorities. I think wherever we are, whatever strength is in this huge group of people who have come here, I think all of them are equally important. And that is what we need to understand, both from this kind of economic aggrandizement and attack we have had, and also from the attacks we have had from religious fundamentalists. They are not prioritized. They have gone and taken over all the spaces that they have seen. And I think, therefore, I see really this as a million mutinies. I really see this as a multiple, multifaceted, pluralistic attack. But that's why I think the coming together of a political ideology of people's politics, or an understanding of being together on certain issues where we bargain collectively, that must be clearly understood. And I think we'll have to bargain for livelihood, we'll have to bargain for employment, we'll have to bargain for health, we'll have to bargain for education, we'll have to bargain for all the basic needs. And today, these basic needs don't only cover the very poor. I think all the affluent, or the lower middle class, has fast slipped into the unemployment bracket. There's so many youth, literate youth, who are unemployed. We must mobilize the youth. We haven't, even here, it was barely touched upon. And I think, 45% of India's population are the young, under 25. Now they must see that they have no future. How many of them are going to get green cards and go to the US? How many of them are going to get into IT programs? Are they going to be part of that 8.5%? How many of them can? So they must also see that they are being completely pawned, mortgaged, that their lives are being mortgaged by a political economic system which has no regard for them. So I think if we look at these areas and work with people, with the large masses of people, and if we still have a democracy, at least functioning democracy in some limited way, we can at least perhaps change.
She's also a member of the National Advisory Council. In 2010, she received the prestigious Lal Bahadur Shastri National Award for Excellence in Public Administration, Academia and Management.
And if you look at South America, you look at what has happened in Bolivia, you look at what has happened in Venezuela, happened partially in Brazil, then why not here? Why not here? So therefore, we'll also have to start internal discussions and internal arguments. The Dalit group which I talked to yesterday said that they've had no big deal in this. There has been no paradise that they have lost, because the World Bank has not destroyed a system that in which they had everything. In fact, what is there to choose between the kind of new deal that's coming in and the old deal that they had? It is very important that we accommodate and give strength to all the vulnerable groups and give them space in our politics, to take them along with us as equals and place them as members of our prominent members of our team, So we'll have to work politically amongst ourselves, between ourselves also very hard. You know, I think that the leadership of all our movements will have to change. Why am I here? I'm born a member of the ruling elite. I speak English. I mean, today the way I speak English puts me in a class. My role should be played by a person who has come from that particular class. If you look at the meeting, they're all people who are dissidents from the same class.
The Roys show us the rays of hope where people at the helm of affairs and well-to-do backdrops come out from the formal world to the real world to realize their dream come true. The ordinary world always try to find fault with them but fail to challenge their spirit that always grow over expectations with exceptional happenings in the real world of hunger and despair.